Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents In the Company of Crows and Ravens by Tony Angell and John M. Marzluff. Foreword by Paul Ehrlich. Narrated by Danny Campbell. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to illustrations, figures, images, and tables present in the print and ebook formats of this book. The way a crow shook down on me, the dust of snow from a hemlock tree, has given my heart a change of mood and saved some part of a day I had rued. Robert Frost, Dust of Snow, 1923. Foreword. In a world of disappearing biodiversity, enormous attention has been paid to the impacts on birds of growing numbers of people and accelerating consumption. From the dodo to the ivory-billed woodpecker to now Indian vultures, people have been concerned with the extermination of beautiful and interesting creatures, many of which play key roles in supplying vital ecosystem services to humanity. But relatively little attention has been paid to the other side of the coin: the manifold influences some groups of birds have had on human culture. In the Company of Crows and Ravens helps to redress the balance, and in the process gives us a splendid overview of this group of intelligent birds. Members of the crow family are perhaps second only to house sparrows and the pigeon, the most prominent features of urban landscapes in much of the world, and they are infinitely more interesting than most of our other avian close companions. They are much favored by human activities. We create the roadkills and garbage that they love to devour. They are even likely to snatch your fast food hamburger from the picnic table, undeterred by its lethal fat content. And human suppression of many of the raptors that would devour them makes cities and agricultural areas relatively safe havens, especially since they are more than smart enough to outwit people with shotguns. Crows, ravens, and rooks, of course, are themselves vigorous predators and competitors. By helping them prosper, we heighten the jeopardy of more specialized bird species. Not only do corvids tend to thrive in human-made environments, but they have also penetrated our psyches. Scarecrows have become characters in fiction, and Maitre Carbou teaches us lessons in proper behavior. We eat crow, climb to the crow's nest, tear things apart with a crowbar, and are ravenous after a long hike without food. Many human groups have considered them gods. The high intelligence and humanoid behavior of these birds have long fascinated biologists, and have resulted in some wonderful accounts of the comportment of individual species by, among others, Professor Bernd Heinrich of the University of Vermont. But this book is the first to produce a grand overview of the human-corvid complex, and is truly something to crow about. With any luck, In the Company of Crows and Ravens will stimulate more people to connect with nature by enjoying the antics of these easily observed birds, and learning about them and about the complexities of nature in the process. If people can only learn to appreciate biodiversity in the process, then they will join the growing numbers who look at the paving over and plowing under of natural habitats and quote the raven, "Nevermore." Paul Ehrlich. Preface. It's mid-morning, and a single crow has arrived unseen to parade about the lawn outside our open window. Failing to arouse us with visual cues, the crow leaps to the outside railing and calls, two loud, sharp caws in succession. Alerted, we look up from our work, and one of us walks obediently to the kitchen to retrieve a previously saved crust of bread. This morning ritual of bread fetching for our saucy friend has been going on long enough to become a habit. A subtle transaction has occurred between two species that routinely find themselves sharing common ground. A crow has influenced what we do, and we have affected its behavior. Leaving aside the possibility that the crow has derived some twisted satisfaction in first startling and then manipulating us, the bird has certainly benefited from the delivered meal, and we have been rewarded by an intimate moment with another species, not to mention the peace and quiet that ensued once the crow was fed. A good argument can be made that we have trained each other to behave in a way that is mutually beneficial. At first, such an esoteric benefit to a person may seem insignificant, but even brief encounters with crows can be powerful. Robert Frost commemorated his crow moment in his poem, Dust of Snow, which we reproduce as our epigraph to this volume. Let your mind wander a bit now and consider our language, art, culture, and religion. They have all been influenced over the ages by our interactions with crows. Likewise, crows have benefited enormously by associating with people. We have reduced many of their natural predators and issued royal, political, and religious edicts that have forbidden the killing of some crows. Many of the various species known generally as crows are provisioned on massive scales by our agricultural and urban wastes. Is this a uniquely strong and positive relationship between people and a wild animal? We think it is. Crows and people are engaged in a type of mutualism somewhat akin to the one between shark and remora, or clownfish and sea anemone, that you may have learned about on popular television nature shows. Just like the shark that provides its gills, mouth, and other body parts as foraging sites for a remora in exchange for parasite removal, we, by choice or circumstance, provide living space and food for crows in exchange for intellectual, emotional, and aesthetic stimulation. We may also reap direct benefits as crows clean our environments of wastes and pests, and by observing their behavior and noting their mortality, we are warned of harmful pathogens like rabies and West Nile virus. We wrote this book to illustrate and document this apparent mutualism, as well as other positive and negative interactions between crows and people. Our suggestion that a portion of the relationship represents a novel evolutionary force, one we call cultural coevolution, is a new hypothesis we introduce in the first chapters and explore throughout the book. Our fascination with crows runs deep, but are we unusual for our species? Perhaps we are rare in the extent to which we engage our black-feathered neighbors, but our research suggests that strong interactions between crows and people are anything but unusual. We are convinced that crows and people share a long and storied history, a history that probably started among ancestral crows and our primate ancestors, and that has subtly molded both crows and people. Is this history so obvious that it requires no elaboration? Many would question the need for a whole book about crows. Arthur Cleveland Bent, one of the leading chroniclers of bird lore in the 20th century, wrote, "If a person knows only three birds, one of them will be the crow." What he really meant, though, was that everyone recognizes the crow. To us, this is not the same as knowing the crow. Our neighbors often remark that they can tell us everything we need to know about crows in just a few words. They are noisy, destructive, dirty, aggressive, and yes, clever. This epitomizes many people's views of crows as pests, elusive targets for shooters, consumers of songbirds, garden raiders, and symbols of death and filth. And yet others have and do revere crows as spiritual totems, admire their sagacity, and find amusement in their playful and problem-solving antics. In our experience, few people hold no opinion about crows. Crows' conspicuous, bold, and brash ways make most people take notice and form opinions. Differing points of view result because we all know, or respond most strongly to, only a part of the crow. Here we attempt to meld the various facets of the crow so that you can indeed know the whole animal. Are the various impressions about crows simply a reflection of the variety of crow species around the world, or are all crows viewed similarly? Our research suggests that most of the 46 species generally known as crows, including actual crows, rooks, jackdaws, and ravens, are viewed similarly by most people. Many have been both loved and hated through history. Contrasting their ecologies in interactions with people allows us to weave a richer story. For clarity, however, we use lowercase to refer to general and inclusive groups of species like crows and ravens, but capitalize names when we refer to a specific species, such as the common raven or American crow. Crows and people interact in a variety of influential ways. We detail four basic relationships between crows and people in the chapters that follow. We open with a close look at the influences people have on crow evolution and ecology. Next, we examine what crows have done to influence human cultures throughout the world. We follow this with a detailed look at the cultural life of crows, exploring their behavior and traditions, and our influences on them. Last, we open a discussion of what crows seem to be doing to affect our ecology and evolution, and we pose some of the still unanswered questions about crows that make them such an intriguing subject of study. We include an appendix with suggestions on how you can help answer some of these questions, inasmuch as this demonstration of mutual influence is just beginning to be understood and is quite clearly an ongoing and evolving phenomenon. In summarizing a unique history of association, we make the case for cultural coevolution between crows and people. Along the way, we reveal the diverse culture, behavior, intelligence, and adaptability of crows, and depict their elegance and ecological role. Our transition from a historical association with ravens to a contemporary world where crows are our main associates provides the second organizational thread to our story. We first review interactions among people and crows on many continents, emphasizing how these species and people influenced one another. As we delve deeper into the relationship between crows and people, we focus more narrowly on American crows, Corvus brachyrhynchos, and modern North Americans. Through this single common species, we can explore and understand many of the social strategies, physical attributes, and examples of intelligence that have contributed to this bird's extraordinary success amid a world of change. Along the way, we discover that crows and people share similar traits and social strategies. To a surprising extent, to know the crow is to know ourselves. As we think about people's interactions with crows, we must ask some difficult, soul-searching questions that may refine our attitudes and values toward other animals. Because crows have been so successful at exploiting our excesses, some people view them as serious pests. Increasingly, crow populations are being controlled through lethal means, which forces society to argue about the ethics of killing crows and other cognitive creatures. The resolution of such arguments may ultimately help form an ethic that greatly affects our cultural trajectory. Will we be quick to pull the trigger, or will we think about how best to balance our effects on the ecosystem? Are we conquerors or stewards of nature? Knowing the crow argues for stewardship, if only for a selfish reason. Simply stated, to conquer the crow is to stifle one of our powerful and long-standing cultural motivators. Our art, religion, literature, language, and music all draw on crows for inspiration. Life without such inspiration would be less creative, less imaginative, and less mysterious. Our investigations of crows and people have convinced us that people need crows specifically and nature generally if we are to maintain a vibrant culture. After hearing our story, we hope you agree. 1. Cultural connections. Crows demand our attention. When they fly, we too watch and follow. When they call, we listen. When they encounter people, we anticipate fascinating interactions. We are ornithologists and artists, consumed by these common black, noisy birds. Thousands of days spent chasing, drawing, watching, sculpting, searching for, and reading about these birds have rewarded us with a deep understanding of their biology and an unashamed respect for their abilities to frustrate, challenge, inspire, and exploit us. Few people are as passionate about birds generally, or crows specifically, as we are. But our scientific and artistic passion for crows did not prepare us for the impact these birds would soon have on our basic thoughts. Yes, we knew that crows were flexible and clever problem solvers with complex social lives, culture, and communication abilities. But their connections to and influences on humans are far stronger than we imagined. We discovered that crows do not affect just us. They have profoundly affected people all over our planet at every step of human evolution. Cave dwellers scratched images of crows on their walls. Early hunters and gatherers built scarecrows to keep crows from their drying fish and carved totem poles in their honor. Noah counted on crows to find land. Hindus and Japanese sought their wisdom. Shakespeare wove them into his plays. Franz Schubert commandeered their melancholy way in his song cycle, Die Winterreiser. Alexander the Great mistakenly ignored a dying flock of crows as he stood before the gates of Babylon. His soothsayers warned him that evil would follow, and within 2 weeks he was dead. Weeks before taking his own life, Vincent van Gogh painted crows. Rock bands named themselves after them. Hundreds of thousands of ordinary people have desperately sought to understand them. Crows have power, an unusually potent cultural staying power. There are more than 40 distinct species of crows, technically members of the genus Corvus worldwide, which people interact with to various degrees. These include primarily meat-eating ravens and omnivorous crows, rooks, and jackdaws that favor fruit, seeds, and insects. Familiar jays and magpies, nutcrackers, and obscure choughs are close relatives to crows that round out the biological family, collectively known as corvids. We describe and distinguish among many species in the next chapter. Over time, people have come to interact less with ravens and more with crows. This seems due in part to expanding populations of most crow species, whereas ravens have adapted less well to human presence and may well be discouraged by aggressive crow mobs. Important interactions with crows and ravens probably began when our nomadic ancestors hunted and fished. Indeed, the earliest expressions of humankind recorded 30,000 years ago in the caves of Lascaux in modern-day France feature a crow-headed man and a totemic bird form thought to represent the external soul. We imagine that it didn't take an enterprising common raven, Corvus corax, long to associate the triumphant early European hunter or fisher with the possibility of sneaking in to take its share of the carnage. Maybe we shooed away this thief. More likely, we offered food in homage to a kindred spirit associated with the successful kill. Nomadic hunters surely took note of the raven's distinctive calls, savvy, and persistence. Similar interactions must have been common wherever ravens ranged. Aboriginal Australians, for example, were flanked by Australian ravens, Corvus coronoides, which still scavenge around towns and camps to this day. Some evidence of the raven's influence remains. The Han people of the Yukon in Canada, for example, mimicked the raven's calls to attract bears to their hunting areas. Likewise, Eskimo hunters in Greenland associated ravens passing overhead with nearby caribou. Over time, the nearly constant contact among hunters, fishers, and ravens affected our early folklore and spiritual beliefs. Crows and ravens were integral to Tibetan funeral rituals until the 1950s. A dead loved one was ceremoniously cut into small pieces and placed on an altar. Crows, ravens, and other scavengers then carried the departed to the next life. Eskimos tied the foot of a raven around their newborn babies' necks so that, as adults, they would be able to endure long periods without food. Indigenous peoples of North America viewed the raven as a creator, trickster, and messenger. Clans were formed in the bird's name, and its dramatic shape and demeanor inspired carved totemic images, myths, dances, and song. Europeans, too, formed a mythic relationship with ravens. The Nordic god Odin learned about the world from ravens. His corvid connection is evident today in Stockholm, where the Hotel Odin is adorned with raven art, and in Oslo, where a wood carving outside the city hall depicts Odin in the company of ravens. Good luck was expected by the Irishman who saw a raven croaking as it flew to his right side. Scottish Highlanders stalking deer considered a calling raven a sign of good luck. Heraldic figures of ravens and crows were often chosen to represent medieval families and clans. Over time, people roamed less, settling down to farm. In turn, we started interacting more with rooks, Corvus frugaligus, western jackdaws, Corvus monodula, and various other species of crows. They shared our crops and cities and benefited from the conversion of forests to fields. Crows seemed especially suited to capture our ancestors' imaginations. On the Faroe Islands in the northern Atlantic, an unwed girl would throw a stone, a bone, and a piece of turf in quick succession at a hooded crow, Corvus carone, to find out who her husband would be. If the crow flew toward the sea, her husband would arrive from the sea. If the crow flew toward a town, then he would come from the town. But if the crow did not fly, the girl would not marry. The ancient Greeks often associated crows with the god Apollo. Apollo's unfaithful mistress, Coronis, is the source of the word carone, Greek for crow, and the modern scientific name for the hooded crow. Greek culture mirrored Native American culture by portraying crow as a clever liar who was eventually banished to the sky. The crow can still be seen as the constellation Corvus in the night sky riding on the back of Hydra, the water snake. Roosting crows signaled the start of the Sabbath to early Hebrews. The evolving agriculturally based human civilizations wove, painted, and carved crows into impressive works of art. Their language, too, reflected the bird's constant presence. A leader's nickname might pay homage to the crow. Viking chief Olaf Tryggvason was called Crowbone because of his uncanny ability to predict the future from bird bones. If a nun was deemed bad by French peasants, she was known as a crow. Specific omens were associated with the number, timing, and direction of crow sightings. Even subtle differences in the encounter conveyed profoundly different messages. In some Eastern mythologies, for example, finding a dead crow in the road was good luck, but having a live one pass in front of you was bad. As civilizations expanded, fostering conflict and the spread of disease, crows and ravens prospered, but their image began to suffer. The birds feasted on the corpses that littered medieval battlegrounds. People, however, interpreted this predictable biological response as a supernatural sign and came to view crows and ravens as omens of bad luck and harbingers of death. A flock of ravens was called an unkindness, a group of crows, a murder. When the Black Death swept across Western Europe, physicians tending the dying were wrapped in waxed robes and a helmet that mimicked the crow's likeness. The doctors were to be avoided. Even today, this negative association is strong, often stirring our fascination with mystery, death, the occult, and horror. Hordes of crows starred in Alfred Hitchcock's movie The Birds, and a single raven inspired Edgar Allan Poe's famous poem, The Raven. Some modern Japanese still call on wildlife managers to move nearby crow roosts because of the belief that their presence foretells death. The rise of the modern city brought us into even greater contact with crows. Crows flourish with the milder climates, abundant food, and protection from harassment that our cities provide. Their familiarity has enriched the culture of marketing. Think of Three Crow brand spices or Crow's candies. Street people, some homeless call themselves the tribe of crow, and language, as the crow flies, or crow's nest, for example. The black crows and counting crows are popular modern rock groups. Challenges posed by crows also affect our culture through industry, crop protection devices, or scarecrows, and art, Van Gogh's final painting was likely Wheatfield with Crows. Mark Twain, although enamored with crows during his travels around the world, feared what might become of them in India, where he quipped that they cost the country more than the government. Crows continue to act as barometers of our quality of life in our largest modern cities. In Tokyo, exploding crow populations point to a need for better garbage removal. In New York and many other American cities, dead crows are alerting concerned citizens and governmental agencies to the hazards of a rapidly spreading exotic disease, West Nile virus. Crows even leave their mark on modern recreation. School and professional teams emblazon their uniforms with crow and raven symbols and have corvid mascots. Campers in nature parks are discouraged from feeding wildlife, partly in an effort to stem the colonization of isolated reserves by otherwise rare crows. The effect of crows and ravens on our culture is not one-sided. People also affect the culture of crows and ravens. This impressed one inquisitive and driven graduate student from the University of Wisconsin in the late 1970s. Hardened from a tour of duty in Vietnam, Rick Knight drove the back roads of rural eastern Washington and thought about ravens and people. He noticed that people harassed nesting common ravens more in farmland than in rangeland. In response, ravens were much more skittish around farmland nests than they were at rangeland nests. As Knight approached raven nests in rangeland, where people rarely destroyed them, parent birds remained on their nests until he got within 100 yards of the nest site. As Knight climbed to the nests, the less fearful rangeland ravens approached to within a few yards of him, called frequently, and dove at him at a rate of nearly 8 times per minute. In contrast to these bold rangeland ravens, farmland ravens, whose nests were often destroyed by local residents, left their nests when Knight got within 500 yards and kept their distance, even when he climbed to the nest. Farmland ravens called half as frequently as rangeland ravens and rarely dove at the intrepid researcher. Back in Wisconsin, Rick Knight noticed a similar difference between rural and urban American crows. Rural crows have been persecuted by gun-toting farmers and sportsmen for 2 centuries, but urban crows have not. It is illegal to discharge a gun in Madison, Wisconsin. As a result, rural crows accustomed to being shot at call loudly as people near their nest trees, but stay out of shooting range, even if someone climbs to their nest. By contrast, Madison crows are quiet even if a person stands at the base of their nest tree. Should that person climb this tree, however, a crow riot will ensue, complete with aggressive swoops that will occasionally give the intruder a good wallop. Different reactions of crows and ravens to people clearly show us that the behavior of these corvids has been molded by their interactions with humans. We suspect that these different reactions also illustrate deep cultural differences that are evolving in crows and ravens as they encounter cultural differences in people. Persecution by people favors shyness and avoidance by crows and ravens. If shyness develops in some birds by watching other shy birds rather than experiencing it firsthand the wrath of people, then shyness can be said to have a cultural component. In the same way, if urban crows and rangeland ravens remain aggressive toward people because they see their parents and neighbors successfully chase unsuspecting and passive people from the vicinity of their nests, then aggressive nest defense is cultural. Some background will help define what we mean by culture, why we are careful in applying it to corvids, and why we think human and corvid cultures are evolving together. One definition of culture is knowledge and tradition shared by a group that is transferred among individuals by some form of social learning. We have all experienced firsthand the variety of ways social learning accomplishes this feat. When your parents showed you how to behave at the dinner table, or if you copied your friend's tastes in clothing or hairstyle, or advertisements convinced you to buy a particular car, you were learning and adopting the culture of your social group. We diagram some of the ways social learning facilitates the spread of cultural traditions in Box 1. Many anthropologists and psychologists are reluctant to conclude that animals other than apes and humans have culture. Although we are comfortable identifying socially acquired behaviors as basic cultural elements, some scientists claim that culture consists of the set of rules that guide individuals, not the actual behaviors. These rules and conventions must also be encoded symbolically. Others accept that specific behaviors and rules are cultural artifacts, but say that documentation of social learning producing them, especially the processes of teaching, shaping, and imitation, is incomplete. They argue that some behavioral traditions are too poorly studied to show how and if they persist through generations. They offer alternative ecological reasons, independent of social learning, for why some populations behave differently than others. We agree that culture is difficult to document in wild animals, but recent insights into the abilities and frequent opportunities animals have to observe and learn from others have convinced us that culture can and will frequently develop. When observant, intelligent social animals face changing conditions, they may remain more closely tuned to their environment by evolving their culture than by relying on natural selection to evolve their genes. Culture can help animals adjust to their environment within and between generations, but natural selection must work between generations. Natural selection can craft elegant solutions to environmental challenges when conditions change slowly. Likewise, trial and error learning is necessary to meet challenges when conditions change unpredictably and often within an individual's life. But when conditions change at an intermediate frequency that demands adjustment within some generations and consistent behavior between other generations, then social learning is an efficient way to increase survival and reproduction. Humans have changed crows' environments for hundreds of thousands of years, and the pace of that change is rapidly accelerating. To keep up with these new and often dangerous challenges, we think that crows must respond culturally to people. This does not preclude genetic responses or individual learning. Genetic responses are expected and often underlie and co-evolve with cultural responses. Cultural changes may even drive subsequent genetic changes, as appears to be occurring with the evolution of lactose tolerance in people. Dairying is frequent in northern latitudes, perhaps because people with limited exposure to sun need to supplement their natural production of vitamin D. The human body normally produces vitamin D when it is exposed to sunshine. Dairy products also provide vitamin D, but many people cannot digest the lactose in dairy products. The genes that allow lactose to be digested have increased in northern people, in part because their dairying culture favored members of society with the genes encoding lactose tolerance. Social learning does not need to be a complex process. Nature provides ample opportunities for animals to observe each other's conspicuous activities. This public information is routinely used by animals to learn about new foods, new threats, new habitats, and even the quality of a potential mate. Observation and imitation of others is a simple form of learning that allows culture to develop, even if imitation is not perfect. Rudimentary culture may be refined substantially simply by parents guiding the clumsy or inaccurate imitations of their offspring. Some sort of social learning is required for culture to develop, however. Simplistic trial and error learning is not sufficient. Trial and error teaches an individual how to behave, but it does not pass this information along to others. Even though Rick Knight and his colleagues in Wisconsin have not clearly shown that the different ways rural and urban crows defend their nests came entirely from social learning, it must be part of the explanation. Natural selection ensues as aggressive crows are shot and cautious crows are spared. The population becomes more wary. But some crows cooperate and remain with their parents for years. This suggests that many native crows probably learn how to treat potential nest predators by watching and mimicking their parents and neighbors. Such social learning would be favored because it is clearly more adaptive than repeated trial and error learning about the range of a shotgun. Despite the plausibility of social learning in this case, it is difficult to demonstrate that inexperienced birds learn from their social partners' cultural transmission rather than from direct experience, trial and error learning, without detailed observations of uniquely marked crows. The ability to transmit culture through social learning equips social species like humans with a dual inheritance system. We obtain many physical traits, actions, and behaviors from the arrangement of nucleic acids on our chromosomes, that is, through inheritance of genes from our parents. But we also inherit a vast array of cultural traits from our society through social learning. Some researchers call the cultural units we inherit memes, to show the parallel between inheritance of genetic and cultural information. At any point in time, human culture is composed of memes that reflect genetic, individually learned, and socially transmitted information. Realizing that culture can be inherited allows us to conceptualize the process of cultural evolution. Cultural evolution is the change through time in socially transmitted behaviors that results because the behavior either affects the practitioner's survival or reproduction, or it is chosen or imposed by others by conscious or unconscious decision-making. Archaeologists have documented both sorts of change in their investigations of the 2.5 million-year record of human cultural evolution. The culture of horseback riding, for example, evolved quickly in North America, as people without horses procured less food or were killed more easily than those with horses. Similarly, the vocabulary used to define species, habitats, weather patterns, sea conditions, and other attributes important to fishers on Guara Island, Venezuela, evolved by conscious and unconscious decision-making. Because culture is transferred through teaching and observation, it can evolve and lead to predictable differences in behavior between animals that live in different groups. Much as people from different nations, towns, or tribes exhibit cultural differences, so too can animals from different flocks, troops, colonies, or herds differ culturally. Orcas, killer whales, or Cygnus orca, for example, live either as residents or as vagrants, and given their circumstances, develop different hunting strategies and vocal behavior. Vagrant pods roam widely, silently hunting seals and birds, whereas residents live more sedentary lives and noisily hunt fish they have grown accustomed to taking. Perhaps in a similar way, the culture of nest defense in crows and ravens has evolved to match human persecution. We would need to be sure that social learning is involved, but this supposition seems plausible. Humans are such cultural animals that we often take the uniqueness of culture and its transmission for granted. Although few would argue that other animals depend on culture to adapt to their world as much as people do, it would be incorrect to dismiss the presence and evolution of culture in other animals. Culture is a basic biological attribute of long-lived social animals with well-developed memory abilities, such as whales, dolphins, geese, and apes. Cultural evolution is especially likely to guide the practice of learned behaviors, where mistaken actions are costly and environments are often changing. Fishing for termites by stick-wielding chimpanzees, complex song dialects of birds and whales, and migratory routes of snow geese, Chen carolescens, are well-documented examples of culture in animal societies. These skills are not innate and do not merely spring into being. On the contrary, developing these skills requires learning from observing others. The details of cultural development are particularly well known from studies of primates. In an unusually telling case, island-dwelling Japanese macaques, Macaca fusciata, were individually recognized and watched for many years. During the course of their studies, researchers habituated the macaques by throwing food treats onto a sandy beach. Emo, a 2-year-old female, devised several innovations that eventually became cultural norms on her island. First, she washed the sand off her sweet potatoes before eating them. Then she increased the efficiency of eating wheat by throwing handfuls of wheat and sand into the water and skimming the wheat off the water after the sand sank. Imitation of Emo's actions, particularly by other young monkeys, allowed her innovations to spread by social learning. We suggest that crows and ravens have culture, and that cultural evolution is an important reason why they live so successfully with humans. Cultural evolution has likely played a role in the differences between European and North American corvids. Europeans have persecuted hooded crows, carrion crows, Corvus carone, and common ravens for centuries. As a result, ravens are rare and extremely shy in Europe, and crows are found in only a few major cities like Berlin, Warsaw, Oslo, Moscow, and Amsterdam. Crows have only recently invaded these cities, apparently proceeding under the cloak of winter's cold. Large flocks of crows join rooks and western jackdaws to roost during winter nights in cities where the air is warmer and the people are more often inside and perhaps more concerned with the cold than with the annoyance large flocks of crows can bring. Eventually, a few remain as breeders, where they enjoy the protection of new laws against shooting in cities and the lack of attention from most city dwellers who no longer see crows as a source of food. City crows eventually become more used to the new and less threatening urban people, and they join pigeons and sparrows in seeking handouts and scavenging from streets and gardens. But for every tame European city crow, there are hundreds of tamer jackdaws. Jackdaws have been steadfast city residents with little fear of people. Their smaller size, less grating calls, mostly vegetarian diet, and infrequent predation on other birds' eggs or young has probably incited less human harassment. Jackdaws, crows, and rooks are abundant outside European cities, but again their history with people is reflected in their present culture. Jackdaws have been persecuted the least. They are still easy to approach and hardly fear people. Rooks have been persecuted around their noisy nesting colonies and remain warier of people. Rural crows are still hunted and often persecuted because their diet includes sickly animals, birds' eggs, and the young of birds prized for hunting. Therefore, as in North America, rural European crows are extremely wary and quick to fly from people. Our closeness to many crow species causes us to continually shape crow culture. Indeed, the speed with which we change the environment and the dangers we pose gives cultural evolution an edge over genetic evolution. Compared to the glacial pace of genetic selection, recombination, and mutation, cultural innovations spread quickly. They are also durable. Unlike individual learning, which is superior to social learning when conditions change often within an individual's life, cultural traditions allow individuals to gain knowledge from their contemporaries and ancestors. Just think of the variety of foods crows must have learned to recognize during the past century to flourish in a typical city. Fruits and vegetables from around the world, cooked meats of all shapes, sizes, and colors, bread, pastry, noodles, ice cream, potato chips, sauces, and our personal favorite, the cheese puff. How did crows and ravens come to recognize fluorescent orange cheese puffs as food rather than bits of plastic? Derek Goodwin, a British authority on crows, similarly wondered about the ability of crows around the world to recognize bread as food. Because bread is fabricated and does not resemble natural foods, Goodwin suggested that crows learn to recognize and eat it, then pass this tradition through the ranks. They test new foods to see if they're edible, watch what fellow crows and people eat, and quickly incorporate an ever-changing variety of foods into their diet. At the same time, they avoid getting poisoned. English poet Ted Hughes summed up the essence of the crow's adaptability in his poem, Crow and the Birds, 1971. While the bullfinch plumped in the apple bud, and the goldfinch bulbed in the sun, and the wryneck crooned in the moon, and the dipper peered from the dew ball. Crows spraddled head down in the beach garbage, guzzling a dropped ice cream cone. Another type of cultural innovation that may be important to crows is the use of tools. This is always a controversial concept among scientists, but New Caledonian crows, Corvus monodeloides, have unquestionably evolved sophisticated tool manufacturing and use. Cultural evolution may be responsible for different traditions of tool use by these amazing crows. Although all New Caledonian crows use a variety of tools to extract insects from decayed wood, and a propensity to use tools is partly innate, some populations specialize in the use of hooked tools, while others use only straight skewers. American crows have been observed to hunt by herding sparrows into the sides of buildings to stun them. In settled areas, crows drop thick-shelled nuts, clams, and tough-skinned squirrels on roadways, and then let the automobile traffic render their food. These novel techniques expand the wild crow's toolkit, which already includes twigs, splinters, and leaf stems used to extract spiders and insect larvae from crevices. The tool-using capacity of crows enables them to exploit novel feeding situations and profit even more from human society. Crows need to solve new problems quickly to keep pace with changes in the human environment. This may in turn put a premium on their ability to develop unique calls. Their calls vary regionally, like human dialects that can vary from valley to valley. Some of the regional variation in crow calls may arise culturally. When crows join a new flock, they learn the flock's dialect by mimicking the calls of dominant flock members. This is cultural inheritance. Cultural inheritance of dialects might allow urban crows to quickly develop scolding calls for hawks that are different than those employed for cats. To perfect begging cries that motivate people to put more peanuts in the feeder, and to warn other crows of impending trouble. From our observations and those made decades earlier by Nobel laureate Konrad Lorenz, it appears that humans who consistently harass local crows are eventually singled out and given special alarm responses by the birds. Whenever we walk across the University of Washington's campus, crows take our names in vain, warning all who know the language that the crow trappers are afoot. We don't know how they pick us out of the 40,000 folk scurrying like giant two-legged ants over well-worn trails, but signal us out they do, and nearby crows flee while uttering a call that sounds to us like vocal disgust. In contrast, they calmly walk among our students and colleagues who have never captured, measured, banded, or otherwise humiliated them. Some aspects of crow and human culture appear to evolve together in a mutually reinforcing way, like the crow parading outside our window. When animals exert an evolutionary influence on each other in this coupled manner, we call it coevolution. Predators and prey coevolve as each selects for adaptations in the other. In this way, prey may come to see more keenly or act more cautiously. A familiar, albeit more peaceful, example of coevolution is the relationship between hummingbirds and the fancy tubular flowers they visit. The bill of the hummingbird has evolved its long length and decurved shape to reach deep into the flower's corolla and sip high-energy nectar. The flower has evolved hidden nectaries deep within its corolla to keep other organisms from stealing the sugary syrup and to ensure that any honeybird that probes for nectar also gets doused with pollen. In this way, as hummingbirds go from flower to flower for food, they pollinate plants. By reserving the nectar for particular hummingbirds, the plant gains a reliable and highly mobile pollinator. Hummingbirds and plants engage in a closely coupled coevolutionary dance. The shape of the flower evolves in response to a hummingbird's bill, and the bill's shape evolves in response to the shape of the flower. Coevolution can produce new flower or hummingbird species, or even lead to differences in bill shape among male and female hummingbirds of the same species. On the Caribbean island of St. Lucia, for example, male purple-throated carib hummingbirds, Eulampis jugularis, are smaller than females and feed on heliconia plants with short corollas. The larger females have long curved bills and feed on deep-flowered heliconia. The deep-flowered heliconia also contain more nectar than the heliconia with shallow flowers, which helps the larger females meet their greater energy demands. Specialization on flowers that differ in shape has caused male and female hummingbirds to evolve different bill shapes. Reliance on small males or large females for pollination has caused flowers to evolve differences in nectar rewards. Usually, we reserve the label coevolution for genetically based traits that evolve in response to interactions between organisms. We extend the concept of coevolution to situations where interactions among species lead to social learning and evolution of each species' culture. We call the coupled changes in two or more species' cultures that evolve in response to interactions between the species cultural coevolution. Moose culture, for example, is modified by the culture of predators. Where bears or wolves prey upon moose, the moose react to wolf growls and howls and even the sound of ravens, who associate with wolves. But where moose do not live with their traditional predators, like wolves and bears, they are also unresponsive to predator culture. Likewise, those vagrant orcas mentioned that hunt silently for seals may be exploiting the cultural coevolution that has occurred between resident seals and resident fish-eating orcas in Washington's Puget Sound. Resident orcas have culturally derived dialects that pod members use to communicate noisily because salmon do not react to their clicks, whistles, and whines. The local seal culture has been shaped by ignoring the sight and sound of familiar fish-eating orca pods that present no threat to them. Considerable time and energy is thus saved by Puget Sound harbor seals, Phoca vitulina, because, with sharks being rare here, they have been living a predator-free life for many generations. Occasionally, humans and the odd eagle take a young pup. But in 2002, a band of vagrant orcas stealthily entered these waters and ate nearly half of the unsuspecting seals. These examples suggest that one species' culture can respond to another's culture. But is such cultural coevolution possible between people and animals? The Boron people of East Africa and a drab bird called the greater honey guide, indicator, indicator, have closely intertwined their behaviors. The honey guide is a specialized forager on the wax and larvae of wild honeybees, but despite its appetite, it cannot efficiently raid the hive of the honeybee. Hives are usually deep in tree crevices and vigorously defended by stinging swarms. The Boron people love honey, but they cannot efficiently locate the widely spaced and inconspicuous hives. So they work together, honey guide and human. A Boron man, Hussein Isaac, and researcher Yuli Ryer, measured how honey guides adjust their flight pattern, vocal behavior, and perching behavior to actively, accurately, and consistently lead people through many miles of dry bushland to honey-laden hives. Birds reduce the search time of people for honey by roughly two-thirds. Because of this benefit, the Boron culture includes a specific and loud whistle known as the fulido, sounded by blowing into shells, nuts, or a closed fist when a search for honey is to begin. The fulido doubles the encounter rate with honey guides. Clearly, the culture of following honey guides by the Boron people has evolved by social learning, passing traditions along family lines and from elders to younger group members. But honey guides and the Boron probably are not culturally co-evolved. The behavior of honey guides is not likely a result of cultural evolution. Honey guides are not social species, and they are not raised by their kin. They are solitary nest parasites, like cuckoos, that are raised by adult birds of another species. Their abilities to guide people and other animals to beehives most likely develops through individual trial and error learning, or is mostly innate, purely genetic, because their solitary life and lack of association with parents precludes most sorts of social learning. Honey guides teach us that intricate mutualisms among people and animals alone are not sufficient to infer cultural coevolution. When humans interact with highly social species, cultural coevolution is increasingly likely. Bottlenose dolphins, Terciops truncatus, have fished with people at Laguna off the coast of Brazil since 1847. During this time, dolphins have developed a culture of driving fish into fishers' nets, signaling to fishers, and feeding on stunned fish. This behavior is cultural because it is learned socially, persistent, and not found in all dolphin populations. Fishing with people has lasted for at least three dolphin generations. Young dolphins imitate or are taught by their mothers to herd fish, avoid nets, and signal fishers. The culture of fishing with people is not evident in all bottlenose dolphins, although it has evolved independently in several dolphin species that live in close association with fishing people. The culture of fishers includes an ability to interpret distinctive roll dives performed by dolphins. The intensity of these rolls, perhaps like the calling and flight styles of honey guides, tells the fishers how many fish the dolphins are herding and where to cast their nets. Fishers rarely cast their nets until signaled to do so by dolphins. Co-evolving cultures of herding and signaling by dolphins and interpreting and netting by humans allow both to fish cooperatively for mutual benefit. Few humans live in cultures closely co-evolved with dolphins. If cultural coevolution is to regularly occur between people and animals, it most likely involves species we frequently interact with that are long-lived, intelligent, and social. In other words, crows. Relationships between crows and people are multifaceted. Because people have such rich and variable cultures, we affect crows in many different and often opposing ways. These have changed through our history. As we have suggested, our first contact with crows, and especially with...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.